Thornbury, Gloucestershire, John Richens has done the same round for 25 years. He drives a 19-year-old float.
We're going round to number three now. Mrs. Teague likes it on her front door rather than her back door, so I'd do that one just before we get to the roundabout.
These days, with cheaper milk available in supermarkets, doorstep delivery and the milk float survive largely through customer loyalty.
The electric milk float is wonderful because you never hear it. It's very quiet. It just arrives and departs without any fuss at all.
Oh no, we don't hear it in the mornings. In fact, he's the quietest milkman in Thornbury, I'm sure, because we're in bed when he comes, and often we don't hear him. And he opens and closes doors so slowly and quietly, and he puts his milk bottles in so quietly, we wonder sometimes how he does it.
Customers have said to me, we very rarely hear you, John. It's rather nice. And sometimes when people move new into a road and they might say, well, I never hear you. I say, well, it's just rather nice. I got a battery milk float. It's so quiet.
Their silence is appreciated not only by their drivers, but by the residents of the roads and streets through which they make their way.
Back in the 1930s, the milk float wasn't the only electric vehicle to be found on the streets. It was just one of a number, delivering all sorts of provisions, like bread and tea, to the doorstep.
In Britain, they're everywhere, doing their work regularly, efficiently, and unassumingly. Whether the streets are clear or crowded, it's completely at home in them.
The electric vehicle, then as now, relies on simple battery technology which dates back to the turn of the century. It is made up of a chassis, a ton in weight of batteries, a motor, and an electrical controller. The motor draws power from the batteries and drives the rear wheels via a prop shaft. The weight of the batteries meant that the electric vehicle needed to be heavily built.
Because it had to carry a ton of batteries, you couldn't build an electric vehicle with a flimsy chassis. It had to be built like a tank, because with no milk on it, it still was a very heavy vehicle. So if you didn't build it with a very solid suspension and chassis frame, you were in trouble before you started.
For delivery vehicles doing the same job day in and day out, the battery had one great advantage. You could determine the exact amount of power needed for each route.
It became very important in selling electric vehicles to people, the idea of an electric, to measure the job carefully and relate the battery directly to the job it had to do, so that you used most of the battery. You just had a little bit in hand for the odd snowy day and that sort of thing, but not much beyond that, because otherwise you bought battery you were never going to use.
Factors like the length of the route, the amount of hills, and the number of stops and starts were used to determine the size of battery needed. The system remains ideally suited to the job of delivering milk.
I deliver between 800 and 900 pints of milk daily. The number of customers would be around 550. The number of stops would be approximately 300 to 350.
Such stops add up to a considerable waiting period each day. But no current is being wasted while the vehicle is at a standstill, and no wear and tear involved. It has many virtues. However cold the weather, it's always simple to start. After unplugging the lead by which the batteries are charged, the driver just gets in, switches on, and drives off.
The milk float is so easy to operate for the stop-start situation. there is so little to do when you start off. It's just release and handbrake, foot on controller, and go. There's no starting of the engine, there's no clutch, there's no gearbox. It just automatically puts itself in the best speed for the situation or gradient that it's on. And it's so easy to stop again. You just take your foot off the controller, brake on, and out you hop.
The driver reverses by turning a switch.
I do worry so much about reversing. Just sadly, unfortunately, I knocked a person down one day reversing. Although I didn't hurt her too much, I did knock her down. And it's always been a worry to me since that time. It happens so very easily. Right, that's that part of Waterford done. Onto what I call my second part of Waterford now, starting at 53. And she has 3 pints. 2 silver, 1 red. These battery milk floats are so easy to work from, though. It's just not true. I've used petrol and diesel, and they're so accessible and so not so tiring to work from. They're a real treat to work from, you know. And you can work either side, which makes them so good. It's as easy to get out the passenger side as it is the driver's side. It makes it so accessible, really.
They were designed, weren't they, for easy access.
Oh, yes.
For the roundsman.
In one side, out the other.
Yes.
There was no one single design of the milk float. A number of manufacturers like Morrison's, Smith's and Wales and Edwards saw their potential for the milk industry and began to produce them seriously after 1945.
Where this toy now is, you remember there's a round piece in there, isn't there?
Do you know, I can't remember that.
Stanley Woosnam and Mervyn Morris worked for Wales and Edwards on the design of the three-wheeler.
Well, you used a bishing tool, you used to call it.
With one float much the same as another, small modifications made all the difference to the dairies.
When we built the first vehicles, the Unigate would only have this type of seat.
Well, yes, well, when you get the fabric thing, with the fabric thing, I mean...
You used to get your backside wet, didn't you?
Well, apart from that, it used to get torn and worn and all that.
But these were better for... because the water used to run through them.
That's right, yeah.
When the driver was pulling, it wouldn't release, do you remember?
Yes, I can remember that, yeah.
You know, so we put a kink in it, so...
Makes it easier to operate.
But it was some time before the dairies took up the milk float with any real enthusiasm.
They were being made for a very minor market, I suppose. In the pre-war years, dairymen who had electrics were cranks. They liked something different, you know, they liked something special.
The dairy industry already had a perfectly satisfactory means of delivering milk to the door. The horse.
I think anybody who's been a horseman of any kind, railway, on anything, coal dealers, anything, they're absolutely fantastic. And that one I had, it was really... It used to be a pleasure to come to work.
How's my lovely Nelly this morning? Hungry? Oh, I'm only kidding.
You can talk to him like a human being, really. You can just walk up the street and just say, come on, stop, come on, stop, come on, stop. And they'll go on and stop. They know the round as well as what you do. Where you stop regular, they used to go along and then stop on their own. They're really fabulous.
They didn't like the electric vehicles. I mean, there's nothing friendly about electric vehicles. And most of the old drivers, the horse was next to their wife, wasn't it, more or less? And I mean, they used to go in the morning and sort the horse out and groom it and do all this business. And at night, same thing again. Electric vehicle, plug in, finish, cold. No life in it for them at all.
But the mechanization of the dairy industry in the 1950s gave the electric vehicle the push it needed. Mechanization meant rationalization, and the days of the horse were numbered.
There is no room in this world for small, niggling firms.
And old-fashioned, too.
Right.
They still use a horse.
They've got an electric boat that tears uphill like a bomb. Now, you can't expect Nellie to gallop uphill full stretch with a full load now, can you?
You've got a whip, haven't you?
The electric float became associated with all that was clean, modern and efficient. The smaller dairies and the horse were left behind.
The larger companies gradually took over the smaller ones, and you got enormous fleets.
You have the finest equipment and the best milk in the country. All you need is initiative. So go out in your territory and sell milk.
Right, men. Carry on.
It was during the 1950s and 1960s that the electric float became synonymous with the home delivery of milk. As dairies got bigger, so did the size of their fleets, and the electric vehicle industry experienced its one and only boom.
In the heyday of the electric vehicle, I can remember in the days when I used to pride myself on being a genius. I used to sell 400 vehicles in a year, which took a bit of doing. And I used to think it was great.
Get with the finer people, go with the lively crowd. Happy and healthy, that's how they plan to stay. With a pint per person per day.
Get at the same time, milk was being vigorously promoted as the key to a healthy family. The electric vehicle industry became increasingly reliant on the milk business.
Like a pint per person per day.
The dairy trade was very suited to the electric vehicle trade, and we liked it. So we tended to concentrate on it. And I would think that the electric vehicle manufacturers must have made 99% of their output was dairy trade.
Depots like this one in Leeds were built specifically to house large numbers of floats. In its heyday, over 100 operated from here.
We used to start here at 4 o'clock in the morning, and we'd 1 hour, just 1 hour, to get all the milk out, back of each truck. Every milkman's milk went at the back of his truck. And they used to start at 5, load up the trucks, come round and be checked out, and they used to go and get back as soon as they finished.
It's at the depot that the floats are maintained and serviced. The routine has changed little over the years.
The roundsman on completion of duties comes back to the depot. He has some paperwork to complete, but the main thing is that his vehicle goes on his charger. That is obviously to bring the batteries back to capacity ready for the following morning. Each vehicle has an allocated charger. It's the roundsman's responsibility to put his vehicle away, to put the vehicle on charge, put it into neutral, the power's on, and then he leaves it.
Routine maintenance is a matter of only a few minutes weekly. As far as daily duties are concerned, all there is to do is to plug in. The vehicle then services itself, whilst its owner attends to other business.
The batteries are maintained weekly, levels are checked. Obviously there is a service pattern for them, but they are very, very easy to maintain.
Giving long service, cleanliness, and freedom from fumes at low upkeep. They need only occasional replenishment with distilled water. The batteries, we mean, not the milk bottles.
We service the floats every 12 weeks. We basically strip them down, wheels off, things of that nature, and check brakes, steering, the usual type of service that you would do on any vehicle. Difference is, of course, we check contacts, things of that nature, instead of engines and gearboxes.
With no engine and few moving parts, there is little that can go wrong with a milk float. The only uncertainty, as with any battery vehicle, is running out of power.
It's as the batteries get older that you do run into battery power problems. Normally it begins to show up, first of all, on your lights and wipers and the sort of sundry things. And then you find that you can't do your collecting or you can't quite finish the round. And it then starts to be a major problem. And of course, when you run out of power out on the round, it's then a job to get back. You've got to be towed back.
The batteries is a bit dicky at the minute, like, but it gets ruined, we ain't chuck it, you know, it'll get us back to the depot, like, sort of thing. We've had this set of boot, 7 years, and that's all I expected to get out, you know, out of them, like, about 7 years. But, we've done very canny.
Milk floats use lead-acid batteries, whose chemistry and weight combine to make the vehicle one of the slowest on the road.
I can get from 0 to 60 in a fortnight. And, well, it's at times I've got to wheel the pedestrians on. No, well, it's got a thing here, not to exceed 12 mile an hour, you know. But it's champion going down the banks, but it gets a bit tired going up them.
On the flat, or climbing a hill, is no problem. You've a maximum speed anyway. The dangerous part is, or the temptation for the roundsman is when you get on a hill, depending on how steep the hill is, obviously the vehicle will just keep increasing speed until it shakes to pieces, practically. There is a maximum permitted speed, and obviously we are very strict if we do find anybody abusing that, because it can damage the vehicle.
If the milk float is slow, the milkman has earned a somewhat racier reputation.
No, it's not as racist as what people make it like.
It's worse.
It's worse.
Oh, thank you, milkman.
I'm just a very quiet milkman, drinking plenty of coffee and having a chat. I do hear about the myth, though. We're a very quiet lot, really.
Now when it's sizzling summer heat, milk delivers. When it's rain or snow or sleet, milk delivers.
For a vehicle that has to go out in all weathers, the float offers the driver little protection.
You can certainly be sure milk delivers.
The milk float is very basic as regards comforts. You just have to be very prepared for most elements of the weather. It is rather a nightmare in the frost. The inside glass freezes as well as the outside glass, and you just cannot see where you are going then.
When we first started, it was a bad year for the snow. We had to rough it, we had to carry the milk up and down the streets because the float couldn't take the road, could it, you know?
No. It doesn't like the ploughing through the snow, it doesn't like that bit, you know. And it's not as though you can drive in the tracks with what other vehicles have made, because we're only having that the three wheel, you know. I'm going to plough my own way through, like, you know.
There's more than just bad weather to contend with these days. The last few decades have seen a steady decline in the home delivery of milk. Alf and Len's round has gone down from 720 pints in 1978 to just 400 now.
milk industry is in a very difficult period at the present moment. They're facing severe, or we are facing severe competition from all angles. Supermarkets, corner shops, everybody is trying to sell milk cheaper and cheaper.
This has taken its toll on the manufacturers. Smith's Electric Vehicles in Newcastle is the last remaining company to produce milk floats from scratch.
When we came in here, we're producing in new vehicles about 10 to 12 a week. And now, two or three, that's about all. It's definitely gone downhill, the electric industry.
The few that they do produce are still built in the same way. The chassis has to be strong to take the weight of the batteries, and it's this durability which has compounded the industry's decline.
I suppose we had the seeds of our own destruction built into the vehicles. They were extremely well built, and that was it. We were hung with the results, and really hung, because the complete vehicle was no longer an attraction to a man who couldn't mend it.
We've got vehicles here that, I don't know, 1969, 70s. But milk flows do last quite well. As long as the chassis is solid, everything else can be replaced. I mean, axles, rear axles especially, are very rarely go wrong. The diffs do. Front axles can wear out. But rear axles are quite good. Electric motors are very good. As long as you keep the brushes maintained and replaced, they last for a long, long time.
Many of the new-looking milk floats on the streets today are likely to be made up of an old chassis which has been fitted with a new body. At the Co-op in Birmingham, they haven't bought a completely new milk float since 1976. Instead, they concentrate on refurbishing existing ones, recycling everything right down to the seats. Alan Rushby has been signwriting milk floats for 20 years. Unlike many other industries, this is still done by hand at the Co-op.
I love the job. It's not so repetitive as it's been for years. And virtually there's something different to do every week now, especially with the different Bobby Bottle themes.
Bobby Bottle is a nationwide campaign to arrest the decline in the home delivery of milk. It even has its own walking, talking mascot.
I normally wait for when school fights are happening, and then I'm asked to do it. It's just to keep the little kids happy.
This is the Bobby Bottle gang. There's Bobby Bottle, Carol Cream, Roberta Yogurt, Emma Egg, and Tommy Taser.
Well, I do get teased by the people who work at the dairy, and the ones who are mechanics at the garage. We'll just have to learn to handle that.
Bobby Bottle and his pals will face an uphill struggle. Even in the last 10 years, there has been a 20% decline in the number of homes having milk delivered. Perfectly good milk floats wait patiently for the day when their services are required once again.
Fortunate in as much that we're both single, we've got near debt, you know, and we've it's not as though we've fancied fast cars or the fast life.
And there's, a lot of people still prefer the milk delivered.
Although we wouldn't give up our milk from door to door, it's grand. No carrying, you say. If we want anything, eggs, if he hasn't got it on, he gets it the next day. He's the most helpful milkman I know of.
Embarrassing.
That's another here. That's another pint tomorrow.
All right. All right.
If we keep up a good regular time with a good quality product, that hopefully everybody will be happy with that. And speaking for myself, I appreciate the customer loyalty greatly.
I've had so much pleasure out of knowing John in the 22 years, and I can't say a word against him. I don't know what else to say, because he's just a wonderful guy.